This episode is brought to you by our patrons on Patreon. If you'd like to support the MCP, go to bit.ly/morbidpatron. That's bit.ly/morbidpatron. Thank you. Humans are fascinated by gore and violence, but even more so, the mysterious and unsolved. Interest in these disturbing and unpleasant subjects is called morbid curiosity, and it has gripped hundreds of people throughout the ages. I am one of those people. My name is Hallie, and this is the Morbid Curiosity Podcast. Trade is a powerful motivator. Even today, many countries are willing to put their differences aside to maintain trade of goods between them. Around the end of the 10th century, Norwegian Vikings sailed as far north as Ellesmere Island in what is now Canada, just adjacent to the most northern tip of Greenland, in order to hunt and trade with the native people, now known as the Inuit. By the end of the 15th century, many European colonial powers sought to discover a commercial sea route to Asia, circumventing North America. Between the 15th and the early 20th century, numerous expeditions went into the Arctic, seeking a northwest passage from the Atlantic to the Pacific. The Northwest Passage, as we know it today, was discovered piece by many explorers. The waters of the area are full of icebergs and pack ice, which is made up of pieces of ice that have frozen together and float with the current. Pack ice can build up to be well over 100 feet high and able to crush a ship up against the shore should the right-sized wave push it in that direction. The seabed in the area is also very shallow, increasing the likelihood of ships running aground and becoming stuck in the ice on land. The first successful and complete journey by water through the Northwest Passage was made by Norwegian explorer Roald Amundsen, who traveled from Greenland to Alaska in 1909. Before this, however, many attempts to complete this journey failed. Several explorers gave up not long into their attempts. One of them, Captain Cook, the famous British explorer and cartographer who charted much of the northwest coastline of North America in 1776, made several attempts to sail through the Bering Strait, the sea between Russia and Alaska. Each time, the strait proved impassable due to ice. Cook became incredibly frustrated and eventually gave up. Other explorers decided to press on. It's no surprise that many of these journeys ended in disaster, with ships being abandoned as they were frozen in place or surrounded by ice and unable to escape. In this episode, we're going to talk about these derelict, abandoned ships, often called ghost ships. Some of these examples are apocryphal, meaning the story is taken as true, but there is no documented evidence to support it. Others are completely true. One of the oldest and more famous apocryphal ghost ships is the Octavius. The date given for the discovery of this ship is October 11th, 1775. The most common version of this ghost ship story states that a whaling ship called the Herald saw the Octavius drifting just west of Greenland, and thinking it was a derelict or abandoned, they boarded it, hoping to find supplies, cargo, and an answer to why the three-masted schooner was empty. When the crew of the Herald searched the ship, they found that it wasn't empty. The whole crew of the Octavius was still aboard, but every single one of them was frozen solid, perfectly preserved at the moment of their deaths. Many of the crew were lying as if asleep in their bunks, but the captain was found at his desk, pen still in hand, leaning over his logbook. The last entry in the logbook was dated to November 11th, 1762, meaning the ship had been ghosting through the icy waters with a frozen crew for 13 years. The last entry allegedly said that the ship had been lost for 17 days. It's said that the captain of the Herald took the old logbook with him when he and his crew fled the Octavius, but that the logbook quickly fell apart due to ice damage, leaving no evidence that this encounter had taken place. This is the story of the discovery, but an origin story has also circulated, and the most common version of this is that the Octavius left England for the Orient in 1761 and successfully made it there the following year, traveling east around the southern tip of Africa. The captain, not wanting to take as long on the return journey and wanting to be the first to discover the Northwest Passage, decided to risk traveling from Asia to England by sailing east over North America. The Octavius quickly became trapped in the ice somewhere along their journey, and then drifted to the supposed location where they were found. The legend of the Octavius remains just that, a legend. There is no evidence that a ship named Octavius ever sailed from England to Asia, nor any evidence a ship was found with its entire crew frozen to death in the Northwest Passage. There are varying reports on where the ship was found, with both Greenland and Alaska being named. There are also tales of other ghost ships that share some or all of the elements of this story, adding credence to the theory that the story of the Octavius is completely fictional. In 1828, a newspaper called The Ariel, a literary gazette which was based in Philadelphia, published a story about a nameless ship that was discovered floating in unnamed icy waters with its entire crew frozen in place. Captain Warren, who found the ship, stated that the logbook found in front of the frozen captain had its last entry dated as the 11th of November, 1762, the same date as the Octavius story. But in this case, the entry claimed that the ship had been lost for 70 days, not 17. This exact article, word for word, was reprinted in the newspaper The Republican Advocate in January of 1847, almost 10 years after it was published in The Ariel. The story was again printed in the South Australian Register, a newspaper out of Adelaide, Australia, in June of the same year. In 1862, there was an anonymous article in a popular German geographical magazine called The Globus that spoke of a ghost ship by the name of Jenny, which was a schooner that had been found in the Drake Passage at the southern tip of South America, with its entire crew frozen to death. The Jenny was said to be found by a whaling ship named the Hope in 1840. The story goes that the logbook was again found in front of the captain, who appeared to have frozen as he wrote the last entry. There are two versions of what the last date of this entry was, May 4th or January 17th of 1823. In this story, the logbook was also taken by the captain of the Hope, but has never been recovered. In 1905, the Blue Adventure book was published, a compendium of so-called historical stories of adventure. It contained the story of a ship called the Gloriana that was allegedly found in the same year as the Octavius, 1775, with its entire crew frozen, including the captain seated at his desk, with a logbook that's last entry was on the same date as mentioned in the Octavius story. The Gloriana was said to have been discovered by Captain Warren while aboard his whaling ship, the Try Again. The location where the Gloriana was found is not mentioned. This story about the Gloriana was repeated in 1937 by the Nunatsiak newspaper from the area of Canada where the Northwest Passage begins on the Atlantic side. The Blue Adventure book was cited in the article as the source of the story, but as the Blue Adventure book does not cite sources and was written for entertainment purposes, it's not much help in determining if the story is based in truth or not. In 2013, fiction writer David Mayer attempted to find the source of the legend of the Octavius. The earliest version of the tale that he could find was the 1828 article from The Ariel, but he was unable to find any records of an English ship called the Octavius or the Gloriana, or of any ship with either of those names being launched or found abandoned. Mayer's research was the only evidence-based information I could find on the Octavius. If you know a well-researched book about the search for the truth in the case of the Octavius, please let us know. For now, this tale remains unsubstantiated. A true, well-documented, and frankly more morbid tale of ships that were abandoned and a crew that met an icy end is that of the HMS Terror and its sister ship, the HMS Erebus. Both of these vessels were part of Sir John Franklin's failed expedition to find the Northwest Passage. A total of 129 men were lost in this incident, many of whose bodies were never recovered. Sir John Franklin was a British explorer who set out from England in 1845 to find the Northwest Passage from the Atlantic side of North America. Both his ships soon became stuck fast in the pack ice just off King William Island in about the middle of the passage. Franklin died in 1847, and in April of 1848, the remaining crew of the Terror and the Erebus abandoned the ships and attempted to make it back to civilization by crossing the ice and tundra on foot. One by one, already weakened by badly preserved food, they died, leaving behind journals, artifacts from the ships, and several corpses, which were preserved in the freezing temperatures. Britain sent search parties soon after the ships disappeared. This search effort contributed largely to the mapping of the area, making it easier for future sailors to attempt the Northwest Passage, but the ships and many of the bodies were nowhere to be found. Modern search groups found the corpses of several members of the crew in 1981 and discovered that the men had very high levels of lead in their blood. It's likely they had lead poisoning due to the tinned food that served as their rations during the journey. The HMS Erebus was found in 2014, and the HMS Terror was found in 2016. The Terror now sits on the seabed in almost pristine condition near King William Island. It's unknown if this is the location in which the ship was abandoned, or if it drifted to this location afterwards. I've got requests to do a more in-depth episode on Franklin's expedition, so let me know if you'd be interested in knowing more. I know Tara and Matthew are. As I said, after Franklin's entire expedition disappeared, many ships were sent out in search of him. Two of these ships are the HMS Investigator and the HMS Resolute, both of which had the misfortune of being claimed by the icy waters of the Northwest Passage. But before we continue, let's pause for a word from our sponsors. Our regular sponsor is Audible.com. Audible can provide you with interesting and engaging audiobooks. In fact, there are over 180,000 of them to choose from, which you can listen to on your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or other MP3 players. MCP listeners can get a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial of Audible.com by going to www.audibletrial.com/MCP. You can also find this link on our Facebook page and website. If you sign up for the free trial, you get a free audiobook that is yours to keep, even if you cancel the service as soon as you finish downloading it. And the MCP gets the funding it needs to keep bringing morbid history to your ears. So go get your free audiobook on us. Lastly, if you like this podcast, why not sponsor the MCP yourself by becoming a patron on Patreon? There are several tiers of patronage, the lowest being $1 an episode. With that dollar, you become eligible for several rewards, such as access to our patron-only feed and being entered in a monthly raffle. When you become a patron, it helps us keep this show going. If more people become patrons, we may even be able to eliminate the need for sponsors. That means no break in the middle of the show. If you'd like to become a patron, go to bit.ly/morbidpatron, that's bit.ly/morbidpatron, and you'll be directed to our Patreon page, where you can choose your rewards. You'll have our eternal gratitude. And now, back to the podcast. the first of the two ships sent in search of Franklin's lost expedition and claimed by the Northwest Passage was the HMS Investigator. The Investigator was a survey ship that went through massive strengthening efforts against ice before it was sent to the Arctic to look for Sir Franklin's expedition. This strengthening involved steel and iron plating on parts of the ship on both the inside and the outside. Even with this precautionary measure, the ship became stuck in the ice of Mercy Bay, just north of the Northern Territory of Canada, in 1850. For 3 years, the 66 members of the crew survived the desperately cold temperatures, suffering from scurvy, frostbite, near starvation, and according to the ship's surgeon, Alexander Armstrong, madness. The crew eventually abandoned the ship in June of 1853, and most were successfully rescued. The derelict remains of the ship were slowly mined for copper and iron by the local Inuit people until it finally sank sometime before 1915. The wreckage, which was lost for around 150 years, was discovered on Banks Island in 2010 by Parks Canada, sitting just 8 meters below the surface of the water. Robert McClure had been captain of the HMS Investigator. He kept very detailed logs on everything that occurred, which is how we know the struggles of his crew while they were stranded on the ship. Alexander Armstrong also kept a diary and published his unofficial account in 1857. This document is available online. In 2013, Canadian journalist Andrew Cohen published Lost Beneath the Ice, which is an excellent resource if you want to know more about the HMS Investigator. Another ship claimed by the ice in search of Franklin was the HMS Resolute. The Resolute was a merchant ship that was purchased by the British for the express purpose of searching for Franklin. It was specially refitted for the task, which included installing stronger timbers, an internal heating system, and making a polar bear the figurehead of the ship. The Resolute's search for Franklin in 1850 to 1851 was unsuccessful, but the crew and a new master, Sir Edward Belcher, a British naval officer, renewed the search. Belcher was given several ships, and the squadron set out in April of 1852. They made it to Beechey Island in August, which is near the center of the Northwest Passage. The ships then separated to search for Franklin's expedition, and also gather supplies. One of these ships, the HMS Intrepid, actually found the HMS Investigator in 1853 and rescued some of the crew, as did the Resolute. In August of 1853, a cold front blocked the only open water out of the passage with ice and completely encased the Resolute. As the current went west to east, both the ice and the ship were forced to move east at a pace of around 1.7 miles or 2.8 kilometers per day. By the spring of 1854, the Resolute was still trapped and traveling east with the ice flow. Belcher ordered the captain of the Resolute to abandon the ship. The captain obeyed, and in May, both captain and crew left the Resolute where it was, locked in the slowly moving pack ice. They made a hard march across the ice toward the other ships in the squadron, which were still near Beechey Island. The men that made this trek over the barren wastes included the officers of the Investigator, who had thought their trials and suffering were over when they were rescued. Two more of the Belcher Expedition ships were also abandoned, the flagship Assistance and the steamship Pioneer, due to being stuck in the ice. The entire mission was a complete failure. Even after Roald Amundsen successfully navigated the Northwest Passage in 1909, ships were claimed by the treacherous Arctic waters. The reason people kept attempting to use the passage was the fur trade. The local Inuit people hunted and traded valuable furs to Europeans for objects of iron and copper. Even in the early 1900s, when the fur trade was tapering off, it was still profitable enough for hunters to live in Alaska and Canada's remotest regions for months, hunting pelts and trading them in the spring and summer at outposts on the coast. The Hudson Bay Company was in charge of shipping these furs. They had a fleet of ships which traveled along the passage, stopping at remote outposts in order to pick up furs and deliver supplies. In 1920, the company acquired the SS Baychimo, a solid iron steamship. The ship came to them as part of the reparations paid by Germany to the Allied powers after World War I. During the war, the ship had been named the Angermanälven, after a river in Sweden, and was under German control. The ship had been specially made to deal with Arctic conditions, and was therefore a dependable vessel for traveling the passage fur trade routes. It had several close calls over the years it functioned as a merchant vessel, such as running aground and being damaged by bad weather in 1922. The ship had so many close calls that year, the captain resigned, believing it was too dangerous to continue trading along that route. A new captain, Sidney Cromwell, took over and set out for the Arctic from England in February of 1923. More close calls occurred. For instance, the ship became involved in an international dispute between the US and their rising adversary, the Soviet Union. The incident involved the Baychimo rescuing a ship that was being held hostage in Siberian waters. The Baychimo was also involved in another rescue in 1924, when it assisted another ship, the Lady Kindersley, which had become stuck in the ice of the Northwest Passage. The Lady Kindersley had to be abandoned, but the Baychimo was able to assist with the rescue of the crew. The very next year, however, in 1925, high winds pushed the Baychimo into the shore, denting the hull, and then the ship was stuck fast in the pack ice. The crew was able to repair the damage and get the ship free, but the Baychimo's luck had begun to run out. In 1931, the Baychimo left Vancouver in July, headed east with Captain Cromwell and 36 crew. They made the 8 stops that were routine by then and turned to head back to Alaska. The weather changed suddenly, and an early winter set in, bringing with it blizzards and pack ice. By September, only a narrow stretch of water remained for the ship to sail through, and on October 1st, the ice closed in around it. The Baychimo was stuck not too far from the Alaskan village of Barrow. Despite their best efforts to break free, the ship was stuck fast, the only movement available being the flow of the ice. The crew turned the engines off and hoped for a thaw. Instead, they were hit by a blizzard. Worried the ice would close in and crush the ship, Captain Cromwell ordered his crew to leave the ship and set up a shelter about 1 kilometer away in Barrow. There they stayed for 2 very cold days. On the 3rd day, the temperatures rose and the ship was suddenly let free. The crew rushed back to the Baychimo, started the engines, and were able to steam away at full speed towards home. However, their relief was short-lived, as the ice set in again that evening. This time, they were truly trapped. The crew did what they could to keep up their spirits as they faced the prospect of spending the entire winter out on the ice in the ship. On October 8th, while they were playing sports on the ice in front of the ship, the ice split under their feet. The Baychimo was free, but it was being pushed toward the shore. Assuming the ship would be crushed into the rocks and leave them stranded, they radioed for help from the Hudson Bay Company. The company sent 2 aircraft to their location, and on October 15th, 22 of the crew were airlifted to Nome, Alaska, over 700 kilometers away. The captain and 14 of the crew stayed behind. They were to wait near the ship through the winter and sail it to the Hudson Bay outpost once the ice melted, as the ship still contained thousands of dollars worth of furs. The crew built a small shelter from emergency repair timbers a short distance away from the ship and resigned to wait out the winter. The Baychimo was caught up against a wall of ice and held fast. Every day, one of the crew had to leave the shelter and break the gathering ice off the ship's propeller. That way, if the ship was released, they could get the engines going as fast as possible. On November 24th, a terrible blizzard trapped the crew in their shelter, making even this small task impossible. Once the blizzard had passed, the crew emerged from their shelter to see that the tower of ice was still there, but the Baychimo had vanished. Assuming the ship had sunk along with the cargo, the crew abandoned their shelter and headed for the mainland. Along the way, they met several Inuit seal hunters, who stated that they had seen a ship drifting about 70 kilometers away to the southwest. The crew hurried in that direction, and there was the Baychimo, an empty ghost ship full of cargo. The ship was still surrounded by pack ice, making salvage next to impossible. The captain made the decision to abandon the ship, and the crew did their best to load as much of the cargo as they could onto sledges using the lifeboats. They soon left the ship and were eventually picked up by another aircraft sent by the Hudson Bay Company. Months passed, and the Hudson Bay Company received strange reports from many Inuit people that had seen the derelict Baychimo drifting back and forth along the icy waterways. The ship was seen in 1932 near Nome. In 1933, it was seen near the spot where it was originally abandoned. Later in 1933, a group of Inuit hunters spotted the ship and went aboard to attempt to salvage some of the cargo. A freak storm blew in, and the 30 people were trapped on the Baychimo for 10 days without food, waiting out the storm. The ghost ship Baychimo continued to be sighted now and again for the next 30 years. It was last spotted in 1969, stuck fast yet again in the ice in the Beaufort Sea, north of Alaska. Reports of the vessel have ceased, but it's still not known if the Baychimo sunk or if it's still drifting in the waters of the Northwest Passage. No wreck has ever been found. If you want to read more about the SS Baychimo, has a great ebook for a low price on Kindle, and Anthony Dalton's 2006 book, Baychimo, Arctic Ghost Ship, is also available and an excellent resource. The Northwest Passage to this day remains a dangerous route for ships to travel. Over the years, only 410 ships, mostly Canadian icebreaker ships, which are made to break up the packed ice, have completed the journey through the passage. The first commercial cruise ship to bring its 104 passengers safely through the Northwest Passage did so in 1984. Commercial shipping companies are only recently beginning to consider the Northwest Passage a viable route, thanks to the melting of the ice pack due to global warming. The unpredictable weather and shallow seabed are still an issue, but the passage has not claimed many ships in the modern age. Still, its history as a deadly route, a route that has produced numerous ghost ships, wrecks, and deaths, keeps companies cautious. If you want to know even more about the history of the Northwest Passage, I recommend Martin Sadler's book, Resolute, The Epic Search for the Northwest Passage, and John Franklin, and the discovery of the Queen's ghost ship. The people who attempted this journey knew the risks, the cold, the isolation, the monotony, and the high potential to be stuck, possibly forever, in the ice floe. The desolation of such a bleak landscape and the thought of help being near impossible to receive is why these tales of frozen ghost ships spark our curiosity. The Morbid Curiosity podcast was produced by H. Lloyd. If you'd like to get in touch or suggest a morbid topic for me to talk about, you can tweet the show at Morbid Podcast or find us on Facebook and Instagram at Morbid Curiosity Podcast. If you like the show, please share us on social media, and please, please, please give us a rating on iTunes. Your shares and ratings help us reach new listeners and expand this wonderfully creepy community. Thank you to everyone who commented, suggested topics, shared MCP posts, liked or followed the MCP on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and gave us ratings on iTunes. People like John Frederick, Eileen, Anna, Michelle, Allison, Red Devil, Heather, Unicorn Dragonfart, Harlan's Emporium, Rhymes with Christopher, and Undeader Than Thou, Sarah, Holland, Nathaniel, Casey, Katie, and Elizabeth all have my eternal gratitude for becoming patrons on Patreon. Thank you. Because of you, the listeners, our creepy community is growing, especially on Facebook, so head over there to engage with other listeners, discuss episodes and news articles, and share your own creepy stories and cute pet pictures. Thank you to everyone who participated in this year's Morbid Curiosity podcast on Facebook. I loved seeing all of your adorable pets. It really made my day. And so many nerdy names. I absolutely loved it. The MCP is part of a wider creepy community known as the Belfry Podcast Network. Check out the other shows on the Belfry Network at www.thebelfry.rip. If you'd like some MCP merchandise, an enamel pin was created for the MCP by Rad Girl Creations. If you'd like a pin, go to bit.ly/morbidpin to get yours before we run out. That's bit.ly/morbidpin. As I said before, if you really like the MCP, please consider becoming a patron on Patreon. You can also give one-time donations by going to our website, www.morbidcuriositypodcast.com, and clicking the donate button. On our website, you can also find links to all our social media and sponsors, and other ways to contact us. If you'd rather contact us by mail, this address is also listed on the website. Another way to help the show is by going to our Amazon wishlist at bit.ly/morbidwishlist. On this list are items that will help us improve the podcast, improve our workspace, and some things that are just for fun. Any purchases from this list are greatly appreciated. We are eternally grateful for your support. My name is Hallie, and until next time, thanks for listening.